hello and welcome to another episode of Scoliosis Dialogues. My name is Charla Fischer from NYU Langone Orthopedic Hospital, and I will be your podcast host today. I want to welcome our guest today, Chris Ames, who will be talking about his Hibbs award-winning paper from the annual meeting entitled Genetic Age Determined by Telomere Length is Significantly Associated with Risk of Complications in Adult Deformity Surgery Despite No Significant Difference in Chronological Age, Pilot Study of 43 Patients. So welcome. Thank you for joining us today. I'm so excited to talk to you about this.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to be with you and to talk about the work that we did and the work of myself and my colleagues here at UCSF.
Now, if it wasn't clear from the title, this was the annual meeting Hibbs Award in the basic science category. Why don't you just give us a small summary of the study and what you found, and then we'll dive into some specific questions.
Sure. Well, to kind of set up the background a little bit, as you know, our research group, the International Spine Study Group, and I have been working for many years on trying to develop risk stratification tools for scoliosis surgeons. And we have worked through creating indices like frailty. We've worked in creating some predictive models. And as part of that work, we realized that, you know, we've been constrained working as a research group because you essentially have a certain set of data fields that you decide at the beginning of prospective collection. And then any question you want to ask, you basically have to ask, you know, within those data fields that you're collecting. But we realized that even though we were making a lot of progress, especially in building kind of accurate predictive models around predicting complications, that, you know, to quote Donald Rumsfeld, there were a lot of known unknowns. So we knew we weren't collecting, for example, like physical strength metrics and walking speed metrics. We subsequently, you know, corrected that. But we also realized that there was a huge elephant in the room, essentially, that we weren't collecting anything to do with the genetics of aging. And that can be telomere length, which is significantly associated with aging, things like inflammation, the effect of aging on bone, for example. So this is just one of many variables we were trying to fill in. So we realized that we had a unique opportunity here at UCSF. Telomeres were originally identified here by a Nobel Prize winner named Elizabeth Blackburn. And that's one of the great things about working at a major institution like this is, you know, they're a lot smarter than we are. I'm just an MD. I am far from winning a Nobel Prize or anything like that. But we just reached out to her in her lab and she said, sure, absolutely, we'd collaborate with you. Essentially, what we did was we looked at the impact of telomere length on major complications and we compared it to some other metrics that we had been working on and others had been working on. For example, frailty, Charlson Comorbidity Index, ASA, these are things we all grew up with that were linked to risk of major surgery. And we found that more than any of the other variables we looked at, including looking at things like the spine SAGE calculator, the spine risk assessment tool, that actually it was telomere length more than anything else that was associated with risk of complication in this pilot study. And on average, the patients that experienced major complications were about 10 years older genetically, even though chronologically there was no statistically significant difference in the age of the patients that had major complications or had no complications. So it was quite an interesting study for us. It was a small study, so we were really glad that the SRS paid attention to it. We weren't really sure, you know, how the SRS would react to a small pilot study, but I think it gives us a lot of food for thought, which maybe we can talk about, you know, next, but a lot of food for thought about where to go as a research group, as a research society, in terms of what we want to do in the future to help us make surgery safer and more predictable for the patients.
Okay, great. So let me break it down. So telomeres are at the ends of our DNA, correct?
That's right. Telomeres are non-coding regions at the end of chromosomes. And as we age, as cells divide, they slowly get shorter. They're, you know, if you want to think design wise, we don't really know why we have telomeres, but we can think that it was designed to kind of protect the ends of the chromosomes during sequences of cell division. So they don't get kind of ragged and affect the coding regions of the DNA. Telomerase, which actually helps to make telomeres and repair telomeres, actually telomerase activity, the enzyme gets less and less also as we get older. So telomerase activity itself deteriorates as we age. And so it becomes a marker of cellular aging because it sort of slowly deteriorates over time as cells divide. And most commonly, we're looking at this in cells that divide, like blood cells, skin, other dividing cells. And also they've been looking at it in cancer as well. For example, cancer cells become immortal. Their telomeres don't shorten, and telomerase activity tends not to deteriorate really in cancer cells. And that's one of the reasons that the cancer cells become immortal and difficult to control.
Well, that's really interesting. So how do you see this, you know, sort of the logistics in the future? You send someone for a blood test or maybe a skin swab, then you get maybe some sort of score, and that helps you to understand their risk of complications. Like, how do you see this sort of operationalizing in the future? I know it's just a pilot study, but you must have some ideas about where this can go.
Yeah, exactly. The idea would be to try to create something that's pretty simple and pretty easy, reproducible, that all labs could essentially conduct in the future, that would give us and contribute to a risk score for patients undergoing major surgery. I mean, isn't it amazing that you can't lease a car or you can't buy a house without having somebody give you a risk score? It's like a credit score, right? But you can sure enough have surgery. I mean, maybe the only people that were giving risk scores was anesthesia. They were giving an ASA grade or something like that. But, you know, it's not even like the surgeons often don't even know what the ASA scores are on these patients, right? So the idea was to identify a simple lab test that may by itself contribute to a risk score, not just in spine surgery. If you think about deformity surgery really as a model system for complex surgical care, many of these patients are older, maybe for all surgical patients. And perhaps maybe even bigger picture, more important than that, would be thinking of how this genetic component could be mixed in to other things that we might collect, like frailty scores, measures of sarcopenia, measures of inflammation. And it's really probably not going to be through one simple test like a telomere. But if you think big picture, a few years in the future, it's probably going to be a series of things we're collecting on patients, measures of their bone health, measures of their inflammatory state, maybe measures of their fibroblast activity, telomere length, and mixing this into subjective reports of their health across different organ systems. And probably together, this is going to give us the best ability to predict using maybe AI or predictive modeling, how patients are going to do. So I guess more than anything, I look at this like, hey, we've identified kind of an interesting variable that maybe we should add in. Maybe by itself it's interesting, but maybe more so adding it into the rest of the mix is going to be even more important.
Yeah, that sounds really important to get all of your information. This is another data point that you can use as well in talking to patients. So this was a pilot study. What do you guys have planned next? Or maybe it's already underway.
Yeah, well, we're expanding it. So we've even, you know, after we closed the data entry, we were so happy to have the generosity of somebody like Elizabeth Blackburn in her lab to continue the collaboration. We've also started another collaboration. I guess I should say, for those of you interested in your own telomere length, there are commercially available tests. You can actually get them on the internet. And that's where I came up with the idea of the study was I saw this advertised on Instagram, something called
That's amazing.
Telo Years. And you can send away your own, you know, blood and get your own genetic age. There are other commercially available telomeres testing. The other one's called True Age. And I'm not trying to advertise for them, and I have nothing to do with them, to be honest. But it's interesting. True Age, which is the other genetic aging company, they're in Kentucky. Do you know why?
A lot of old people? I don't know.
Yep. They got their start in predicting performance of racehorses.
Wow.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
They do it with epigenetic measures. So they do it through methylation, which is another way to quantify aging. So we have contributed some of our samples to, and we have a collaboration going on with them, looking at whether different measures of aging like methylation that they do versus telomere length may be more accurate or more predictive. They can also look at methylation in different areas of the genome, things to do with your immune system, for example, which may get to infection risk. So overall, what are we doing? We're just collecting more and more and more telomeres. We've started biobanking here at UCSF. which we hope to expand to some other centers soon, where we're collecting bone and muscle and disc, as well as telomeres in these patients. And we're collecting physiologic information, grip strength, muscle bulk, walking speed. And we hope to put all this together again to just make better predictive models in the future.
Oh, that's great. I can't believe Instagram contributed to something good.
I know. Give him credit for something, right?
That's great.
That's a true story. And, you know, if you look on social media now, there are a lot of companies that advertise different like herbs and things that can help you to improve your telomere length. And, you know, a lot of this is unproven. But there have been some studies. There was a study in patients with prostate cancer in, I believe it was Lancet Oncology, that showed that lifestyle alterations, changes in diet, changes in managing stress, mindfulness, and all this could actually lengthen your telomeres. So, you know, one direction you ask, like, what's in the future here? The other direction where we want to go is in trying to optimize patients for surgery. So we don't want to just be saying, hey, we predict that you're going to do poorly or you're going to have high complication rates and, you know, there's nothing we can do about it, right? We can't alter your chronological age, you know, just get ready for what's coming because it's not going to go well. But what we hope to do is say, we've identified you as somebody who is maybe 10 years older than your chronological age. And this is indicating potentially you may benefit from some therapies that may potentially improve your risk of surgery. Alteration in lifestyle, alteration in diet, alteration in stress levels, other variables, not just focusing on telomeres, but it's really part of a comprehensive prehabilitation process. But this may identify someone that's under high stress, high dietary stress, high lifestyle stress, and it is potentially possible to reverse the telomeres. I'm not sure through all the herbs and everything that they advertise on Instagram, but it may be possible to do it at least through lifestyle alteration.
Oh, that's great. So we're one step closer to living forever.
I'm not sure I'd want to live forever, but we're maybe one step closer to being able to alter our patients' futures just a little bit by understanding more about what produces their risk.
Yeah, and making them genetically stronger to tolerate a deformity surgery. Well, I mean, and also you said that this could apply to any surgery, really, any complex, stressful, challenging surgery. So this is really interesting, really great stuff.
I would say one interesting point is if you think about surgery, you know, Mike Kelly, who was also another really brilliant researcher, presented some information about thinking about, and during the Hibbs session, he was the other nominee in the basic science. His paper was great. You know, it's really looking at, if you think about surgery as basically a traumatic injury, essentially, to the body.
Yeah.
And then looking at the various immunomodulation that goes on after surgery and how variable that is. If you think about, you know, telomeres may factor into that, because if you think about all the cell division, and telomeres may be a marker of how well reproducibly and accurately cells are going to divide. Think about all the cell division that has to go on after a T4 to pelvis fusion in an adult. So there's just all the skin healing,
right,
the muscle healing, the fascia healing, the bone healing, all the remodeling of all the cut blood vessels and all that that has to come together. And then the laying down the bone and the inflamed state, but then also the osteoblastic cell division that goes on in healing. So this may be indicating a bit something to do with what Mike Kelly had presented. It may have to do with the body's ability to respond to the need for really a lot of active, accurate cell division.
Great. So, you know, I think that's really interesting stuff, and it really provides a lot of, you know, sort of food for thought. So do you have any suggestions or any advice for, you know, younger deformity surgeons who look to you as a role model for a career in deformity surgery?
Sure. Well, if I speak really just more on the research side, in my career, I've always tried to picture really where the field is going, and try to, like, when you go like skeet shooting, or I'm not a hunter, but if you go skeet shooting, you have to shoot for like where the clay pigeon's going to be, not where it is. So if you look at the field and you want to really contribute to the field in a meaningful way, you shouldn't look at like what the questions are now, maybe, but what do you think the questions are going to be two, three, four, 5 years from now, and what the needs of adult deformity or early onset scoliosis are going to be, you know, 5 years down the line. One of the real keys for young surgeons starting out is to be very comprehensive in their data collection. And, you know, a big thrust of our work is really in, and this factors into it, it's just a piece of the puzzle, is in prediction and predictive modeling. I like to say, you know, any lost information in patient care is a lost opportunity to improve care in the future. So for young surgeons starting out, looking at different types of data they can collect that maybe someone hasn't thought of, being comprehensive in their creating portraits of their patients, datifying the operative process, datifying the postoperative process, looking at patient choices. Another really interesting area is going to be in decision-making. So now we have all this data, right? It's like you walk into Bloomberg or you walk into your financial advisor and we can predict all these different things really accurately, but it's going to come down to how do you as an individual, as a surgeon, as a patient, process all this information? It's something called decision science or decision node weighting, where you have a certain set of personal preference values and you're going to filter the predictions through those personal preference values. And that's what's going to lead you to the best decision for you as a surgeon or a patient in the future. So I think, you know, decision node weighting, decision science is a really good area to concentrate on, but really it's more around creating, you know, big pictures of data.
That is wonderful advice. That's great. Thank you so much. I think that's really helpful to think about where things are going, not where things are. That's really awesome. I think we're at time. Do you have anything else you wanted to highlight? I want to give you an opportunity to talk about all the things you wanted to talk about.
I don't think so. I think we really, you know, had a nice comprehensive discussion about the paper and where it fits into our current models of work and about collecting data. So
okay.
I really appreciate the opportunity, SRS and you, Charla, for interviewing me. And it was great to spend time with you guys today. So
sure. Thanks
for your interest in our work.
All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us for this. And it's been a real pleasure speaking with Chris Ames and his Hibbs award-winning paper. Again, it is called entitled Genetic Age Determined by Telomere Length is Significantly Associated with Risk of Complications in Adult Deformity Surgery, Despite No Significant Difference in Chronological Age, Pilot Study of 43 Patients. So we look forward to reading the manuscript when it comes out in the journals in the next few months. Thanks again.
Thanks so much. See you guys. Really appreciate it.
Hello, my name is Jeff Mullin from the University of Buffalo. We have a special guest, Dr. Sig Berven from the University of California, San Francisco, who'll be talking to us about his award-winning paper from the recent annual meeting. The title of the paper was The Adverse Events in Multilevel Surgery in Elderly Patients with Spinal Deformity, Report of Prospective Evaluation of Elderly Deformity Surgery. So before we jump into that, Dr. Berven, thanks for joining us. I'm not sure if you remember, I had a chance to meet you several years ago when you were the honored guest at my mentor, Dr. Benzel's course in the Cleveland Spine Review. So along with that honor and the Hibbs honor, I think this podcast interview is low on your list of achievements, but thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks so much for hosting this. I appreciate the work you're putting into these podcasts, and I'm honored to be your guest today. I really appreciate that.
So maybe if you don't mind, just give the listeners a little bit of background yourself. So as I said, you're a professor at University of California, San Francisco. So maybe tell us how you got there and how you became one of the world leading spine surgeons.
Yeah, thanks, Jeff. And so I've been in San Francisco now for over 20 years. My training began in Boston. I did my residency in the Harvard Combined Orthopedic Program and actually did a chief residency at Boston Children's Hospital. And at that time, really had a strong and remained with a strong interest in pediatric deformity. I then came out to San Francisco in 1999, and David Bradford and Serena, who was my mentors, I joined the spine fellowship here and did a year of spine fellowship and joined the staff actually in 2000. And I've been here since August of 2000 as a staff member. I'm now the chief of the spine service in orthopedic surgery, and we've really built a terrific team here at UCSF. As you know, we do a large volume of adult and pediatric deformity. And our goal is to contribute towards developing an evidence-based approach to how we manage problems of the pediatric and adult spine.
Great. And so in line with that sort of collaboration you have within your department, I think one of the things I want to talk about tonight is being leader in spine surgery, you collaborate not just within your own center, but this study itself was a prospective trial out of multiple centers. So how did you sort of foray into that as one of these sort of younger deformity surgeons out there? How would you advise us to get started in these multi-center trials?
Well, thanks, Jeff. And that's such an important question, because I think even a high volume center like UCSF and other high volume centers across the country, there's so much we can do within a center. But what's so important about doing multi-center research is the ability to, number one, get larger numbers. And this increases the power of our studies, the ability to really show a difference, the ability to avoid type 2 errors. And number two is that I think it improves the generalizability of our work. A big part of my career has been working on multi-center studies with the spinal deformity study group early on. Our group at UCSF done a lot of work with the International Spine Study Group. And this study was sponsored by the AO Knowledge Forum. In this instance, we had, I think there were 12 centers internationally that contributed patients. And again, by having multiple centers, we were able to enroll relatively rapidly. We enrolled over 256 patients in less than 2 years, all of whom had multi-level fusion, all of whom were elderly patients with deformity. So we enrolled more patients than I think almost any single center could have enrolled. And we also had the ability, the generalizability to see some of the diversity of what's done both regionally and internationally, and to maybe learn from places that are doing things differently. So I think there's a terrific opportunity with multi-center research to be very effective, to get large numbers, and to get information that's really practical to multiple centers.
Great. And it was definitely a great study, I mean, as noted by the SRS given the Hibbs Award. So maybe get into a little bit of the details about the study. So you said it was 12 centers, over 200 patients, elderly patients, big surgeries, two-year follow-up. I guess one question I had is, from your practice, you said there's variance around the country. So if we maybe talk about your practice for these older patients who you're worried about, is there some sort of prehab you do, or what's your protocol for surgical optimization?
Yeah, great question, because a big part of the purpose of this paper was looking at the appropriateness of surgery. In the elderly patients, the demographics of older patients has changed. We've got more older patients internationally. There's a major demand on our healthcare system. And when is surgery appropriate on the older patient versus when might a non-operative approach be more appropriate? Really understanding the expected risks of surgery, the expected complications, as well as the expected benefits is what goes into informed decision-making for these elderly patients. Now, you asked specifically about what do we do to try and reduce risk. And part of what we try and do to reduce risk is preoperative optimization. Here at UCSF, we use a checklist, and it's actually got 14 points. It has to do with blood sugar control, body mass index, bone quality, cardiac status, renal status, opiate consumption, home situation, whether or not people have support at home, functional independence prior to surgery. We go through a checklist to make sure that anything that's modifiable that we can improve prior to an elective surgery, we do work to improve. So we can improve blood sugar control. We can improve oftentimes body mass index. We can improve bone density. We also improve support that people might have at home. So things like length of stay and perioperative complications can often be defined by whether or not people go home. So create an environment where people can go home from the hospital rather than to a rehab or worse, to a nursing home. So there's a lot of opportunity where we can reduce complications. And the next step in this work from this database will be to look at exactly that. Which patients really were optimized prior to surgery? Which patients perhaps came to surgery with some risk factors that might have been modifiable before surgery? So to identify the specific risk factors, odds ratios for those risk factors, and try and see how we could even do better than we did.
It's very good work you're doing. One thing I found, I'm glad you said, was about the social variability of it. So I think one thing my practice I've started learning early on is getting the whole support group to buy in to understand the expectations and what recovery is going to be like and entail. I think that really helps with recovery and improved patient outcomes, which I think a lot of us don't think about really early on. You know, your med school or residency, you don't think about that other aspect of taking care of patients.
I agree. I think that's such an important part of outcome. You know, the social determinants of health, if we look at somebody's self-reported health status, their actual pathology, be it spine pathology or any medical pathology, any allopathic disorder, probably accounts for less than 20% of somebody's actual health status. Socioeconomic factors, income, education, other factors surrounding that are much more important determinants of health. When we look at patients with spinal deformity, certainly deformity of the spine has an impact of pain and function. A big part of recovery has to do with somebody's social determinants of health. Again, their support network, who's helping them postoperatively, to what extent are they able to return to independence versus having people around them. In a subset of people who were able to get home, who were able to get into a safe and nurturing environment, that subset of patients clearly do better than a subset of patients who end up in a nursing home after surgery. So I think optimizing social factors, including family support, having family involved in a surgery, really is critical to optimal outcomes and the good outcomes.
And another thing you mentioned is just the changing demographic of our society, and there's an increased number of old patients who are going to probably benefit from these surgeries. One thing I've been struggling with, maybe your data shows something about this. Do you have a hard cutoff and say, if you're over X years, no matter what else, we're not going to even think about doing it? Or do you think it's all sort of just a sliding scale?
Yeah, that's a really important question, Jeff. And the answer is that I think age is only one variable that goes into it. And I certainly do not have a hard cutoff. What I'm more interested in really is patient's frailty, patient's resilience. And there's actually a pretty poor correlation between age and resilience and frailty. So age by no means has got a hard cutoff. The metrics that we really need to be looking at more closely include patients' independence, resilience, their ability to bounce back from some perturbation of their homeostasis. And that's really kind of the definition of frailty. Chris Ames did some terrific work from our group looking at telomeres, for example, and other senility markers, methylation of different proteins, may be a better marker of age or of the ability to tolerate surgery than age alone. So I definitely don't have an age cutoff. I think over the next several years, we will develop better metrics of senility, better metrics of resilience, better metrics, perhaps even of grit, that will be better predictors of the ability of patients to withstand or to recover from surgery than age alone.
Yeah, so I actually just read that paper of Dr. Ames. That's really fascinating about the telomere age of patients. Maybe it'll become a day in the future where we just get a test to say this could be your cutoff then.
Yeah, one of the interesting parts about that becomes, well, how much of this is modifiable? And indeed, can we change somebody's physiology? Can we change somebody's frailty? Can we change their senility? And I think there's great promise to that in future work.
Yeah, maybe before we move on to sort of more of the results of this, your study we're supposed to be talking about, you mentioned how it was interesting working with multi-center trials. You learn a little bit always from different centers and doing things differently. Was there anything that stood on this study that you took note of, say, oh, wow, maybe I can incorporate that into my practice, or other points from other centers?
Yes, I think there's a lot of variation between centers, and we often talk about the notion of a surgical signature. And for example, at UCSF, one of the things that's probably characteristic of the surgical signature of how we manage deformities, we do a lot of circumferential fusion, anterior and posterior approaches. Many other centers do posterior-only approaches. And we're looking at the invasiveness of surgery as a predictor of outcome. And at this point, there's some evidence that the durability of an outcome may be better with a circumferential fusion, whereas maybe the complications might also be higher with more invasive surgeries. But we'll have more information to share on that in the next year or so. Other things that we've learned are some of the other patient factors that contribute to outcomes and complications. Again, looking at senility measures, looking at frailty, looking at some of the patient-specific metrics of bone density, blood sugar control, opiate use, all of these seem to have a significant weight or significant odds ratio that may increase the risk of complications. And one of the real benefits from this study is going to be getting better granularity on this. This study, one of the great strengths of this study is that we had a large cohort of patients, but we also had terrific follow-up. We had more than 80% of patients with complete data at 2 years, and that can be really difficult to get. And I credit the AO Knowledge Forum for their persistence and their funding of this and the ability to get all that data. but having follow-up on such a large percentage of the enrolled patients is really valuable. I think that this is going to give us incredibly valuable data in the year to come on further distinguishing or further identifying specific risk factors.
Yeah. One thing that sort of stood out to me was there's 36 neural injuries and 39 patients had revisions. Do you think there's a correlation between those, or was the revisions or neural injuries due to hardware placement, you think, and have revision, or what was, what do you think, was there a correlation to those two?
Yeah, really, really important point. I think overall the neural injury rate was about 18%, if I recall. And the correlation between what were the risk factors for neural injury, we haven't gone through that data in granularity right now. Certainly other studies would indicate that revision surgery would have a higher rate of neural injury than primary surgery. I think that the invasiveness of the surgery may also be involved. These were all patients undergoing at least five levels of surgery, and they were primary surgeries, other than some of them may have had a prior decompression, but none of them had prior instrumentation. So none of them were real complex revisions. But having said that, whether or not somebody who had a prior decompression might be at increased risk is important. Our group, the same study group and some of the same centers, did the so-called Scully risk series of patients. In those cases, we were actually doing more extensive, more invasive surgeries. We were doing three column osteotomies, and we actually reported over 20% of patients had a measurable neural deficit after a three column osteotomy. In this case, when we're looking at complications, it was more things like dural tear, postoperative radiculopathy, postoperative numbness or weakness. And we're still doing work to gain further information about the granularity about spinal cord injury, nerve deficit, and we're still gaining further information about that.
Very good. So we're kind of getting a little bit out of time here. So I just want to, my comment is this. I think all points you touched on were, this is really a great study, but it's almost a foundation for future studies, help us tease out what we do to treat our patients better. But until that data comes out, I think I'm going to take away from the study is be able to go to my patients and help better counsel them. Say, this is more user chance complications. It's more of a question of which complication you could be having, or if you have complications, these are your rates. What do you think your big takeaway is, how you're going to incorporate this in your practice?
I think you're exactly right, Jeff. As the real purpose is to try and empower both patients and physicians to participate in shared decision-making and to make informed choices. So when we've got accurate information about complication rates and the type of complications to expect, and also accurate information about risk factors for complications, we'll be able to have patients engaged in more informed discussions and have them really participate in shared decision-making. And ultimately, the appropriateness of surgery is defined by that ratio between the expected benefit and the expected risk. And this paper is really focused on the risk part of that equation. And I hope that this is going to help a lot of both providers as well as patients.
Well, once again, thank you for your time and joining us. Congratulations on the Hibbs Award. I guess before we let you off the hook, any sort of sagely advice as one of the dignitaries in our field you have for all the other young surgeons out there?
Well, Jeff, thanks for the work that you're doing on this podcast. And I think in terms of advice, certainly in my career, the value I've had of working in interdisciplinary studies, multidisciplinary studies has been terrific. I think that there's three things I would emphasize. One would be identify a mentor. Within the Scoliosis Research Society, there are plenty of senior members who've got a lot of experience that can offer a lot as mentors. So whether it's somebody within your institution or somebody without, I think find a mentor that you can work with, somebody whose values you share and somebody who you've got the ability to work with and get guidance from. There's tremendous information we get from our older members. Number two is try and be accountable for the results of your care and look at collecting outcomes. There are lots of tools out there, lots of mechanisms by which we can create an infrastructure for data collection. It's been a major challenge for those of us who have been practicing in the last 20 years. It's been difficult to collect data accurately. It's expensive, but I think it's becoming cheaper and easier to collect data. So collect data on your own practice, audit your practice, look at your outcomes, compare your outcomes to benchmarks. And just the process of measuring that and comparing the benchmarks, I think it's going to lead to improvements of quality of care. And then the third thing is to try and engage in interdisciplinary research. Is once you're actually collecting data, then certainly you're going to find people who would like to share data with you. So find a group. Multiple centers are terrific within your group at Buffalo or within your group locally, but find a group to share data with. And with those kind of numbers, you can really have the power to show differences. So those are my three major points of advice. I don't know how sage they are, but I hope they're useful to some of the junior members of the SRS.
Well, those are great. I didn't even prompt you there. So at the annual meeting, we just announced our first official SRS mentor program. It's a program we're trying to start with the SRS, pairing mentors with mentees who have looking for one. So next year, for all the listeners, look to apply in that program, help expand that some more. So once again, Dr. Berven, thanks so much. I look forward to seeing you at a conference and grabbing a drink sometime.
Absolutely, Jeff. Thanks for the work you put into this podcast, and thanks for disseminating terrific information, and look forward to more time.
Thank you.
Hello and greetings. I'm Masood Shafafy, and I'm a spinal surgeon from Nottingham, UK. I am delighted, or we are going to listen to Dr. Jeffrey Gom, orthopedic spinal surgeon and presenting author of one of the two Russell Hibbs Clinical Research Prize winners at the recent 56th Annual Congress of SRS in St. Louis. Dr. Gom's interesting paper is coming from a well-known and internationally renowned international spine study group. Dr. Gom, welcome to this podcast. Before we start talking about your fascinating paper, I would like to ask you to say a few words about yourself and also a few words about the International Spine Study Group.
All right. Yeah. Thank you, Masood. I really appreciate the opportunity. So a little bit about myself. So I grew up in Kansas. I actually went to medical school at Kansas University, where I started my spine research career with Doug Burton, who is actually in the ISSG and helped mentor me along the spine pathway. Also, Dr. Asher was a big part of that when I was a medical student. And I landed in Louisville, where I currently am, for my orthopedic residency. I worked with my spine rotations in with the Leatherman Spine Group, who I'm a partner with now. I spent 5 years there and then went and spent a year in St. Louis with Larry Linke, Mike Kelly, Bridwell, Dan Rue, those guys before the Max exodus when they all left a few years ago. So I was the last class to go through with all those folks before the fellowship changed pretty drastically. But then I landed back here at Leatherman Spine Clinic, and I'm in my seventh year in practice. And so it's gone by very quick, but I feel like I've got phenomenal training and mentors along the way. And what's pretty ironic about the ISSG is those are the folks that I always looked up to in training and saw their name everywhere, started to meet them around with my, you know, with Steve Glassman and Larry Linke and those guys. And I'm honored to be a part of that group now and be able to be involved and help push the clinical dial forward with regards to research within the spine arena.
Thank you. That was fascinating. And about your paper, it's fascinating. It's a hot topic at the moment with regard to spinal deformity surgery. And obviously, cost becomes very, very important. And you have studied this in a very, very fine details. And I would invite you to talk about your paper, which is mainly regarding adult spinal deformity and cost utility.
Correct. Yeah, so the, you know, within the ISSG, we got several subgroups. Typically, most of my work within the group has been with regards to economics or outcomes in adult spine deformity. So I've always been interested in value and what we do, you know, the story or the history behind it. It's, you know, as a resident, and I was sitting in the surgery lounge one day, and all I hear are people complaining about problems with insurance approval and complaining about getting certain studies for their patients. And, you know, this light bulb kind of went off to where instead of being the person to complain about those issues, I felt like it was, you know, part of our job to show value, right? So I believe in what we do. I believe that we provide a benefit to our patients that we operate on, but in a specialty where especially within spine deformity, where the surgery is so costly, and it's very important for us to show value. So a lot of the work that I've done within spine is to help show this value. And so in the ISHG, over the past, I would say, 3 to 4 years, we've really pushed to increase the robustness of our cost data, right? So there's a lot of factors that go into getting accurate cost data from centers. And, you know, the kind of gold standard for cost is really CMS data, right? So Medicare, what Medicare and Medicaid will pay centers for certain procedures within spine deformity. So that's, you know, that's a little bit easier to get. I wouldn't say it's easy, but easier than direct cost. We spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to get actual cost or direct cost from institutions, which we really found was almost a disaster, is the best way to describe it. Out of the 12 or 13 centers in the database that enroll patients, we were only able to obtain costs from about 4 or 5 of those centers, because the majority of the centers, especially East Coast and West Coast, are not very reluctant to share cost data with folks. So we spent a lot of time really trying to increase the granularity with our cost, so we could analyze value a lot better. And when I start to break down, you know, in my mind, where value comes from, there's been two big focuses that you could kind of group all this granular data into. So number one is patient factors, right? So if you look over the last few years, there's been a ton of work on frailty and how to optimize patients, what's modifiable, what's not modifiable. So in my mind, this value equation can be summed up into patient factors and then surgical factors. What are we doing in the surgery? How invasive is it? How extensive is it? Is it, you know, upper thoracic, lower thoracic? Is it involving osteotomy, et cetera? So these are two big proxies for patient factors and surgical factors, which include frailty for the patient factors and invasiveness for the surgical factors. So those are the metrics that we use to kind of look at those two factors and how they interplay with the value equation. So that was really the premise of the study. And we took all the patients in our database that had 2-year follow-up, and we looked at the interplay between these patient factors and surgical factors and dissected them out to see how they panned out. And kind of what the hypothesis was that the patient factors were going to play a really big role in this. And the reason why I say that was our hypothesis is we've dissected out the variability within surgical factors from center to center across the ISSG. And what's interesting is when you look at complications by themselves, surgical factors make a big difference. When you look at cost, the surgical factors were not as important. It was almost the surgeon or the center had more driving the cost component of it versus the surgical factors. So we kind of went into this knowing that or presuming that the patient factors would be a big part of what is influencing value. So that's what our data really showed. When we dissected it out, there was pretty big variability within cost from center to center and across the patients. And what we found that really the patient factors, right? Patient factors is measured by frailty is what's driving the value equation when we set it up under these study parameters. Again, I know the study parameters aren't perfect, but that's really what was driving the value equation, which is a ratio between cost and outcome. And then to look at it a little bit further, we dove a little bit deeper to try to look at the components of the frailty index. The frailty index we utilized was previously published from our group and looks at 40-some factors. Brian Newman and Hopkins did a great job really defining these factors. Catherine Pierce, Justin Smith, a lot of other folks in the group, Peter Pashis, really helped define these frailty factors. Brian Newman and them worked on the invasiveness component of it and did a great job with that. But what we wanted to do is we knew that frailty as a whole really helped drive this value equation. So we wanted to dissect out the variables within that. And what we found when we weighted those variables, our depression was a big driver. Osteoporosis was a big driver. You know, smoking was a big driver. A lot of these variables that are potentially modifiable. So, you know, overall, the big conclusions of the study were patient factors are driving value within ASD surgery. And a big part of these are modifiable. So not that we need to ignore the surgical component of it, but we really need to start to focus on how can we optimize these patients before these really big and costly surgeries.
Fantastic. We have got also, obviously, having National Health Service, we need to justify the cost effectiveness of interventions. And the price per quality is a cutoff point for approval or disapproval of any intervention, particularly in the field of adult deformity. Did you come up with any cutoff point that the quality is may not be worth the price of that particular quality in your study?
Yeah, so great question. So the WHO defines cost per quality threshold of 100K. I've seen the range for between 100,000 to 150,000 per quality. And to date, there's only been one spine deformity study that has shown that we're really below that threshold. There's been a bunch of modeling studies that have looked at that, right? So Leah Carrion, Steve Glassman, using the ASLS database out to 5 years, shown for the first time that ASC surgery, if durable, can come under that cost threshold, right? But the key to that equation is it has to be durable. It is so expensive up front that if you're revising these patients at 2 years or 3 years, it's not going to be durable enough to stay under that threshold. So our study, depending on how you ran that ratio, initially came in under that threshold, but we weren't happy with the way the qualities were really being calculated. So as we reran it, we're consistent with other studies and we're coming above that threshold. And that's expected at 2 years. With the 2 year follow-up, the surgery is so expensive up front that it's not going to fall under that threshold. So, you know, to me, work needs to be done with long-term outcome in ways to really minimize the need for revision. Or if it's not durable, we're not going to ever beat that threshold to where it's cost effective.
Given the fact that your follow-up is 2 years, and we know from other literature that most or overwhelming majority of complications in adult spinal deformity surgery comes beyond the 2 years, do you have any projection with regard to your database where you heading in terms of cost utility beyond the 2 years?
Yeah, great question. The you know what we've looked at so far in the database, what is most costly are interventions that require additional instrumentation or biologics, so which is PJK or PJF and pseudo/rod fracture. So, and you're right. So a lot of those we're finding now present themselves farther on, not the PJF component, right? So we're going to capture most of those within the first 3 to 6 months, at least within our database. But if you look at PJK, that slowly worsens over time, obviously that gets worse over 2 years. And then with pseudo and rod fracture, what we found that, you know, initially we thought if you're good at 2 years, you're not going to have issues down the road, but we found that that's not the case. And we're finding more and more rod fractures after this 2 years. So I believe we're going to find a similar situation where the value is still not below that threshold for the most part. So we need to do a lot of work to really modify those variables and optimize our patient selection so we can make these procedures more durable down the road.
You mentioned about patient frailty, and some of them are reversible and amenable to intervention to optimize patients and thereby improve the outcome. But there are occasions that these are not reversible or amenable to optimization. In your study, did you come up with any threshold for frailty that perhaps intervention may not be indicated at all?
Yeah, well, that's a great question as well. The issue with it is frailty. What we found is the more frail you are, so the severely frail patients, they have a higher potential to have a bigger improvement. Right. So the delta is bigger because they start off so low. Right. But the downfall to that is they're more likely to have a complication or a revision. Right. So that's the sweet spot within the equation that I think we really need to spend more time on. Right. So of those really sick patients, right, what can we modify? One. Number two, which ones are truly going to get that big delta, that bigger improvement versus the ones that are just, you know, 3 years later, you look and they've been on their fourth, fifth revision and we shouldn't have touched them. that's where we're going to make a big difference in this value equation. So there definitely needs to be a lot of work in that. The other question that was embedded within that is really how much more bang for our buck do we get if we truly put energy in optimizing these patients, right? So if I take a cohort, I put them through 6 months or a year of optimizing their pre-op variables, can I make a difference? And that study's not been done yet, right? And that's a fantastic study to do, but obviously a lot of resources to consume up front and hard to study. But those are the two things that I would love to focus on moving forward with this line of work.
Thank you very much. I think we can sit down here and talk about this topic for hours and hours.
Yes, definitely.
I'm grateful for your enlightenment of our understanding of adult deformity and cost utility. I'm really grateful. Thank you very much.
Awesome. Thank you so much for the opportunity, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, Masood. Have a great day.
Have a nice time. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you, guys.
DePue Synthes Spine, being a proud Double Diamond sponsor of the Scoliosis Research Society, would like to invite you to visit our professional education website at www.jnjinstitute.com and view the comprehensive surgical videos related to cervical and thoracolumbar deformity. For additional information, please contact your local sales representative.
The Scoliosis Research Society is a nonprofit professional organization made up of physicians and allied health personnel. Their primary focus is on providing continuing medical education for healthcare professionals and on funding and supporting research in spinal deformities. Please visit srs.org for further information.